this part of the series, we'll be discussing on common pediatric endocrine emergencies. We have a 12-year-old child who presents to us with fever, lethargy, poor feeding, and rapid breathing. On ear assessment, he is tachycardic with cold periphrase, normal blood pressure, clear chest with normal saturation, and responds appropriately to commands. His blood sugar at admission is 553 mg per deciliter. At triage, we classify this child to have respiratory distress, compensated shock, and hyperglycemia. Two common DDs which we need to consider at this point is sepsis and diabetic ketoacidosis. His initial lab results are back. The child has metabolic acidosis, which is high anion gap with a delta ratio of 1.3. We went ahead and did the ketone levels, which was 4, which is quite high for this child. This satisfies the triad of diabetic ketoacidosis, which includes hyperglycemia with a glucose value of more than 200 mg per deciliter, metabolic acidosis with a pH of less than 7.3 or a bicarb of less than 15 milliequivalent per liter, and ketonemia with ketone bodies more than 3 millimole per liter. Diabetic ketoacidosis is a common medical emergency. Almost 1 in 4 of newly diagnosed diabetes presents with DKA. In normal conditions, the blood glucose absorbed from the body enters into the circulation. The blood glucose stimulates the beta cells of pancreas and promotes the release of insulin. Insulin, when it binds to the insulin receptor, activates the GLUT4 receptors in the cells. The GLUT4 receptors, once activated, will trigger entry of glucose molecules into the cells. These glucose molecules are converted into pyruvate by glycolysis, which enter the Krebs cycle in order to produce energy. The excess glucose molecules are sometimes stored as glycogen in the muscles or may be converted into fats by lipogenesis. In diabetic ketoacidosis, the glucose molecules are unable to enter into the cells because of lack of insulin or if there is a defect in the receptor. This results in accumulation of glucose within the blood vessels, leading on to hyperglycemia. The excess glucose may get cleared by the kidneys, resulting in osmotic diuresis, leading on to polyuria and dehydration. The increased osmolality also stimulates the thirst centers, resulting in thirst. The hormone-sensitive lipase, which is usually inhibited by insulin, gets repressed and leading on to excessive lipolysis with formation of glycerol and fatty acid. These reach the liver, wherein they get converted into pyruvate and acetyl-CoA. The acetyl-CoA molecules are later converted into acetoacetyl-CoA and HMG-CoA. The amino acid catabolism also contributes to acetoacetyl-CoA formation. These acetoacetyl-CoA, which later form acetoacetate, and beta-hydroxybutyrate, which are the major ketone acids of the body. These keto acids are good proton generators. So this results in high anion gap metabolic acidosis. And in order to compensate for the metabolic acidosis, the patient starts to breathe rapidly, leading on to Kussmaul's breathing. And it also stimulates the chemoreceptor trigger zone, leading on to nausea and vomiting. The excess keto acids is then released by the kidney, leading on to ketonuria. Thus, commonly these children present to us with polyuria, polyphagia, polydipsia, nausea and vomiting, and deep and rapid Kussmaul respiration with confusion and drowsiness. The common risk factors include younger age of presentation and adolescent age group, previous episode of DKA, low socioeconomic status, delayed diagnosis, and certain psychiatric disorders. The key management principles include assessing and appropriately correcting dehydration, arrest ketogenesis with initiation of insulin therapy, anticipate and replace ongoing fluid and electrolyte losses, assess and treat precipitating cause, and anticipate and intervene rapidly if any complication occur. It is important to form a local, unit-based protocol while managing children with DKA. Essentially, when you have hyperglycemia, ketosis, and acidosis, we confirm a child to have DKA and we start the rehydration protocol with isotonic fluids. Assume that the child has a deficit of 6.5% to 10% depending on the degree of clinical dehydration and add it on to the maintenance fluid as per Holliday-Segar formula, and the correction is usually given over 48 hours as an hourly infusion. Potassium chloride is added at 40 milliequivalent per liter after ensuring adequate urine output, with an intention to maintain potassium between 3.5 to 5. Insulin therapy is started after the first hour of fluid initiation at a rate of 0.05 to 0.1 unit per kg per hour. Blood glucose and ketones are monitored. Blood glucose, once it reaches less than 250 mg per deciliter, dextrose-containing fluids are started. One need to monitor clinically as well as laboratory-wise till the endpoints of DKA are achieved, which includes resolution of acidosis and return to a normal sensorium with ability to take feeds adequately. If you like these videos, kindly subscribe to the channel for more updates.